In this tape, we will present the combatives, meaning attacking, counterattacking, and defending. We have a tool. When we have a tool, we can use this tool in different techniques. For instance, for us, a punch is a tool. A certain punch is a tool. A certain kick is another tool. The idea now is that we will be able to use all the tools in the body in different techniques, different attacks and different defenses. When we have a target and we'll take this realistic equipment as a good target, we can hit the target in different angles. The five major different directions to hit the target are as follows: straight attack forward, attack from one side with the same limb, and then from the other side, attack upwards, and attack downwards. Of course, all the angles and diagonals are of course possible, but I was saying about the five major directions: straight, from left to right, from right to left, down to up, and up to down. When we talk about distance, the striking distances, we have the long range, we have the intermediate, the medium range, and we have the close range, with the hands, with the head, with the knee, with the foot. Let's talk about striking points and striking surfaces. In general, we would like to hit a sensitive, a vulnerable point at the opponent's body. If we take this equipment as training aid, we understand and we know about sensitive points, such as the eyes, the temples, the nose, the jaw, the neck, especially the windpipe, solar plexus, lower ribs, kidney from the back, groin area, knees and feet are also sensitive places that we can strike and hit. When we talk about the back side of the person, major parts, major sensitive points are in the back of the head, the back of the neck, the kidneys, the whole spine area, and some places behind, such as behind the knee and the calf muscles. Dealing with kicks, you will learn in this tape how to kick and the major directions of kicking. Of course, with a kick with the leg, we can do more or less the same thing as we can do with the hand, which means to be able to attack from down to up, from up to down, from one side, from the other side, and straight forward. When you are going to be attacked, if you're going to be attacked, you may be positioned in different positions. You may be standing, just like we are standing now here. You may be more in a ready position, maybe in a fighting even position. But maybe the attacker will come from the side. If you'll have the ability to prepare yourself better to a fight, you should get into a fighting stance. In the fighting stance, both knees are a little bit bent, shoulder width apart between the feet, the back heel is raised, the forward foot is turned a little bit. From a side view, you will see these points and notice also the position of the elbows, relatively low, protecting the area of the ribs. The palms are about chin's height. When you are in this stance, you can easily attack with punches, kicks, move freely and dynamically. When we need to move while we are in a fighting stance, advance forward or retreat back, we will start with a leg to in which direction we are moving. Moving forward, first front leg, then closing with the back, and retreating, first back, then forward. From a side view, we see this again. Moving forward, 1-2 with the legs, moving back, 1-2 with the legs, keeping the same stance all the time. If we need to move from the fighting stance to the left, we will start with the left leg. When we need to move to the right, we'll start with the right leg without crossing the legs. We'll teach now how to punch. First, bring your hands to height of the chin. We'll start sending the hands forward and back, lightly and slowly, keeping the palm vertical, keeping the hand vertical. Let's see this from a side view. We continue and send the shoulder more into the punch and the weight a little bit more in the punch, turning the heel a little bit out to initiate a longer range in the attack. It is beneficial many times to strike with a closed fist. How to clench your fist? First start with the second knuckles, then with the third knuckles, close your fist strongly and then the thumb is over. Punching with your fists from a passive stance. Strong punches, hitting with the knuckles of the fists, turning the body, sending the shoulder forward. We'll see this from a side view. We are turning the hips and the heels a little bit too. Here we see Michael punching from a fighting stance, sending his left forward, punching with the left. Here it's demonstrated a slow punch, now a fast punch. Michael is rotating his body and shifting his weight forward in order to achieve maximum power and reach in the punch. From a side view, slow punch, shifting the weight forward, rotating the body, turning the body to reach maximum reach and power in the punch. A fast punch. Straight left punches to a focus mitt. we emphasize fast recoiling of the attack. We demonstrate now punching with the right punch with a closed fist from a fighting stance. Michael starts with sending his hand forward, shifting the weight forward, and then turning the body. He is hitting with the two knuckles as with the left punch. His waist is turned and the heel of the back leg is turned a little bit also. With this he can generate a strong punch, shifting the weight forward. From a side view, we can see the punch clearly. His chin is tucked a little bit down to protect him from getting a knockout, a punch. Seeing this from the other side, we can see how his shoulder is being sent forward to gain maximum reach in the punch. Fast punches. A side view of a fast punch. View from the other side of a fast punch. And punching focus mitts. Michael is demonstrating now a combination of two straight punches left and right. As Michael is showing this slowly, we will see first punch, then the second punch goes. The switch between the two punches occurs halfway between Michael's face and the target.
Next, we examine the delivery of the hammer fist punch. It's important to note the name hammer fist punch comes from the physical characteristics of a hammer. The forearm of John, as it is positioned in this point in time, is similar to the handle of the hammer. The fist portion also simulates the head of the hammer. To understand this, we'll understand the delivery of the punch. John is basically using his hand like a hammer, delivering forward and slightly down to a target that is presented before him. This punch could be delivered to the chin, to the nose, or other face area or level of the opponent. John's shoulder goes in, his hip goes forward, and he's pushing off with the ball of his foot, all to generate power forward and in a downward motion, consistent with one striking with a hammer. Notice slowly that when the punch is presented, it's drawn back and the palm part of the hand is presented forward, and on impact there's a turning inward. This rotational force or torque is created to generate additional power on impact. From a forward view, the striking surface of John's hand is the meat part of his hand, which he will touch now. This is the area that he's hitting with. That area is analogous with the head of the hammer. From a passive position, you can see this strike delivered to another target area. For instance, if someone is low, this strike can be delivered in front of the body and downward. In this position, John is making essentially the same strike, but because the punch is being delivered downward, John is dropping his weight accordingly. The hand is raised, and the punch comes down strongly. It could be to the back of the head, or neck area, or even between the shoulder blade. From this view, we can examine another possibility in the delivery of the hammer fist punch. If the threat is to the side, but beyond the distance that is appropriate for an elbow strike, John will employ the hammer fist punch to cover distance quickly and deliver and reach the target that's at a further distance. John uses the hand swinging up and turning in. His weight is shifted toward the target. His hip and shoulder roll out to make power in this punch delivered to the side. He also lowers his head so that he is protected slowly behind the delivery of the punch so that it would be more difficult for him to receive a blow from the opponent. This punch can also be delivered from a passive position and can be followed up with further attacks. Now we break down the delivery of the hammer fist punch forward in its stages. John will be making the delivery of the punch in slow motion. As the hand's going forward, it's raised a bit so that the punch can go forward and down onto the target as the shoulder and hips turn into the punch. Now examining the hammer fist punch downward for a low target. The delivery of this punch is down. The weight will be dropped down. The hand is presented over the target, and it starts to go towards the target with the palm down. Before actually making impact, the hand is rotated to hit with the meat part of the hand, the head of the hammer, so to speak, to deliver maximum power from the rotation that's included in this strike. John's weight drops sharply. The stages in this position will be the hand raised up slightly, and now the hand dropping on the target. In conjunction with the sending of the hand down, John drops his weight, and the hand, the meat part of the hand, passes through the target. The opposite hand is up and available for defensive or offensive purposes as needed. Another possibility from this position is to deliver a strike on a horizontal plane. John will be punching with his left hand. Of course, the hand is brought back quickly for further attacks if needed. In the fight because of the power that can be generated in a relatively short distance. Another advantage of the hook punch is the benefit that's derived from delivering the punch with a bend in the arm. This bend in the arm, the hook so to speak, allows you to pass around any possible defenses in order to hit the target. The body is turning into the punch, pivoting on the feet, turning the hip and shoulder in, along with the hand being exploded towards the target. The right hook delivered quickly, on examination, you can see the weight is turning in to the target, consistent with the angle of the arm that's making the strike. The left hook. This hook draws power from the pivoting on the forward foot, the turning of the hip inward, and again, the shoulder being offered and the hand moving as quickly as possible towards the target. From this frontal view, we'll look at both hooks, the right and the left, being delivered quickly. Notice that Amir's chin is down, being protected by the shoulders from any attack. The rotation of his shoulder, his hips, generated by the turn in the feet or the pivoting of the feet, contributes greatly to the power in this situation. In the next series of strikes, we're going to examine the uppercut punch. This punch is particularly relevant when the target is at a downward angle and we're able to come up and underneath the target, passing through the target with a punch. This punch can occur at an intermediate range or at a very close range with either the forward hand or the back hand. It is particularly important to note how the legs play a vital role in the delivery of this punch. Since our punch is going up, our weight also must be transferred up with the punch and through the target. Close examination first of the right uppercut. In slow motion, what's occurring in this position is the target is low. Amir lowers his body with his weight in the right leg and also in the forward leg. The body then shifts forward towards the target with the hand leading the punch as the body is being raised. The punch travels through the target area and extends a bit forward. The striking point are the first two knuckles, consistent with the straight punches that have been discussed earlier. A side view of the right uppercut. Notice what a vital role the right leg plays in the lifting of the body in exact timing with the punch. Amir drives his weight up with the right ball of the foot. The opposite hand covers for a measure of protection against further attacks that could be delivered, and quickly. Looking forward, we can examine the uppercut punch being delivered with the forward hand. Although this does not offer as much power, the shifting of the weight and the driving of the leg contributes to a powerful strike. In slow motion, you see the shifting of the weight towards the left leg, the driving with the left leg, and the raising of the body in perfect timing with the delivery of the punch. The punch, once again, travels through the target. And a side view of uppercut with the forward hand. The shift of the weight and the driving of the legs in conjunction with the delivery of the punch account for the power. We'll be right back. In this scenario, we're going to deal with close range attacks, specifically elbow strikes. First, we'll show you how to form the elbow. Amir will be demonstrating. He's going to bring his hand into the shoulder area, developing a strong elbow, which will be the striking implement in this particular set of exercises. The elbow is hard, and it's a good striking implement because it's relatively small and can penetrate a target. To note, there are two planes in the system that we use to develop our elbow strikes. One is a horizontal plane, and one is a vertical plane. With regard to the horizontal plane, Amir will now show the full range of motion, both in front of him, to the side, and around him, a bit more than 180 degrees. This plane really means that any elbow strike with his right can be delivered anywhere along this plane, using the technique that we will describe in a moment. The second plane is a vertical plane. This vertical plane rises up in front, can go down, and up and around behind him. Combining this with the other hand, he has a full range of motion, 360 degrees around him, and sphere-like, up and over the top of him, so that he can strike any target, whether it's down, to the side, behind him, or in an upward motion. We're going to do a series of 7 elbow strikes. Amir will be using his right elbow. The 7 strikes encompass the various points on the 2 planes that we discussed earlier. First of all, the first 3 strikes will be horizontal. The last 4 strikes will be along the vertical plane. Strike number 1 is forward and around, striking someone in front of you. Again. And the second strike is to the side. The third strike is for someone who may be a disturbance or a threat behind you. In this scenario, we're going to demonstrate the first 3 strikes along the horizontal plane. Notice a few things. Notice the striking area Amir is going to be presenting to the target. He will be striking in front of him, to the side, and to the rear. He also is looking to see where he is striking before he sends the strike. And before actually delivering the elbow, he is looking and covering himself so he does not expose himself to further danger. Each strike recoils so that we can attack again if necessary. In this scene, Amir will be demonstrating the last 4 in our series of 7 elbow strikes. Strike number 4 will be to the rear and to the solar plex area. Strike number 5 will be to the throat or face area, to the rear. Strike number 6 will be forward and to the face area or throat area. And strike number 7 will be delivered downward to an appropriate target. Notice that each time Amir is striking in this series, he is striking and recoiling quickly. And each time he strikes, his weight is delivered in the elbow strike. Each time he strikes, he is covering appropriately so he does not expose vulnerable areas to further attack. In this next series, Amir is going to be demonstrating the last 4 strikes in our series of 7. That's the vertical strikes in slow motion. Watch for his balance, watch for his ability to recoil, and watch how he looks at the target before striking while covering to make himself safe. Please. To the solar plexus, to the chin or face, striking forward to the face, and striking downward to the appropriate target. A side view reveals his balance the power that's generated in a short distance, and how he covers and looks to be safe. An important element in striking is to use a variety of weapons. In this view, Amir is attacking John. You see the distance between them. He is closing the distance with longer weapons, such as straight punches. When he's in close, he's using intermediate range weapons, such as hooks and uppercuts, that can be delivered to the face, head, or body. When he's very close, he's delivering elbow strikes for infighting. And when he's even ultimately closer, he could use his head as a weapon. And on the way out, he follows the same principle in reverse, intermediate weapons to long range weapon. Up to this point, we've demonstrated striking with the hands and elbows. It's important now to integrate the legs and knees into a complete system of fighting. The legs offer and afford the person who's making the attack a broad range of distance. Your legs are longer than your arms. Your legs are stronger than your arms. So a powerful, full-range distance kick can provide many benefits in the fight. In addition, in close range, we can use the knee as an infighting type weapon, similar to the elbows in comparison to a punch. To make a complete fighter, we must incorporate the legs and knees into the equation of the fight.
In this next scene, we view front kick to the groin. In this scenario, we're kicking up and underneath the groin, and the kick is rising. Generally, the kick is delivered with the instep of the foot, approximately at the same area one would tie their shoes. The knee controls how high the kick is going, and the knee should rise above the target level. The leg opens, and the power is delivered up and through the target. As much as possible and as much as is comfortable, we try to emphasize to keep our hands up to protect our upper body. Elbows are in to protect the rib area. The hip comes forward, which is much like our right shoulder advancing towards the target when we punch. Note what is occurring with the base leg. As the kick is on its way being delivered to the target, the base leg, the heel of the base leg, turns inward so that the hips can extend forward and deeper to develop greater range in the kick and greater power. You can land forward depending on if you make contact and it's appropriate to do so, or in some situations it'll be appropriate to recoil and bring your leg back and behind you. In either case, one should be ready and prepared to follow up with counterattacks that are appropriate for the circumstances. In slow motion, reviewing the kick in its stages, the knee rising and the leg opening and closing, our hands staying up to protect us, and also leaving our hands in a position where we can give further attacks. If we're close, instead of the top of the foot being the striking area, we can strike with the shin. The shin is a very hard surface area and can do great damage to the groin.
In this view, we can examine the kick, the front kick to the groin, in its logical stages. Kevin will assume a fighting stance and slowly will deliver the kick in its entirety. a side view. It's possible that the kicker will want to land forward. If he's successful in reaching the target, there's no sense in bringing the leg back. However, if there should be a reason to retreat, it is also possible to bring the leg back and resume your fighting position from that distance. The stages. As in all attacks, we want whatever the striking implement to be to move toward the target first, to avoid the problem of telegraphing. Here we are striking with the top part or the instep of the foot. The foot will be jumping towards the target first and will lead the attack. The knee is folding and the kick is delivered. A side view. The knee is rising with the foot going towards the target immediately. One is the knee up, and two is the knee out and back, and three is the resumption of the position from which to fight further. In this next section, we deal with the instruction of roundhouse kicks. Like all other striking methods in the system, we want to be able to hit a target from any possible angle and at varying distances. Our roundhouse kick is delivered up and around, and it can be delivered at a very acute angle, or it could be delivered on the diagonal angle. And of course, it should the opponent be on the ground, or the threat be on the ground, still viable, the kick can be delivered in a downward angle. Because the turning of the body, the use of the hips, and the full range of motion involved in this kick, it is a very powerful target. It can be delivered to the leg, it can be delivered to the torso, it can be delivered to the head level. In this view, we can see the roundhouse kick being delivered with the right leg. There's no telegraphing of the kick, and in fact, what is occurring is the knee is being raised and leads the foot. The knee also extends beyond the target. The hips are turning in and the weight is being turned into the direction of the target. Power is generated in a relatively short distance. Notice also that Jared, as he's kicking, keeps his hands relatively up and in a protected position so that he is safe from any additional attacks that may be sent in his direction. In slow motion, please. Like other strikes, the striking implement, which is the top of the foot in this case, leads the kick. As the foot is coming forward, the knee is bent and remains bent as the kick passes through the target. As the knee passes the target unobstructed, the knee is opened and the foot is creating power on the pad in order to catch up with the knee. The turning of the hip, the turning of the shoulder inward, and the placement of the body weight ensures that this kick will have power. Specifically here, we note what is occurring with the base leg. As Jared is kicking, it's important to note that basically the base leg is on the other side of the target. This will ensure that when kicking, the kicking leg will want to pass through the target and not merely to the target. Of course, as Jared is kicking, he is shifting his weight and pivoting on the ball of his foot. This also allows further range of motion. Should Jarrett be closer to the target, he will be delivering this kick with the shin. This is a very, very hard striking surface and can be delivered to various areas on the body to cause damage. Here's an example of the various levels at which this kick can be delivered. A kick to the leg is very strong, and also because of the sensitive nature of the muscle at the quad area of the leg, inflicts great pain. Such a kick can even deaden the feeling in the leg. Notice that Jared is turning his body very sharply and that he's delivering the kick with his shin. His right shoulder is up to protect him as much as possible from any punches or other attacks that may be thrown at him. This same kick can be delivered to the rib area. This essentially is the same type of kick. And of course, at this level, the kick can be delivered with the top of the foot, or even the ball of the foot. The kick can also be delivered with the shin, the ball of the foot, or the top of the foot at the head level. With Wade's hands in this position, Jarrett will deliver the kick around Wade's left arm. He is using the foot in a flex position and kicking with the ball of the foot to reach the target, up and around the raised arm of Wade. If Wade's hands are lowered, and if Jarrett prefers, he can kick now with the instep. It's not necessary to go around any possible block or defense. And of course, as demonstrated earlier, you saw that Jarrett can deliver the kick with the shin to the face. In this view, we can see the development of the kick. Comparing it to the front kick, it's similar in nature, very similar. In fact, the front kick is delivered on a vertical plane forward. As the angle of the kick changes towards the diagonal, it's now approaching a horizontal angle, it becomes the round kick. At the very top level, it can be a very sharp angle on a horizontal plane. In the middle, it could be more of at a diagonal angle. And forward, you see it returns as the front kick. In this view, we'll examine the round kick delivered with the forward leg. Again, we'll draw the comparison between a front kick. It's a similar kick. From this position, you can see the knee raising for the front kick. The front kick is being delivered and is raised in a vertical target forward. From this position, once the kick is placed on the diagonal angle, you can see the formation of the round kick. The appropriate turning of the body to accompany the direction of the kick is incorporated. It is even possible to see the kick form so that the kick is actually being thrown parallel to the ground, completely in a horizontal position. As with other kicks, the kick can be delivered advancing or retreating or moving laterally. This will be saved for another tape.
We are presenting you now with another set, another family of kicks. This time, the kick will be striking to the target in a straight line. We call this the family of stomping kicks. So, the attack can be directed to different directions. For instance, stomping down, hitting down towards the target. Hitting forward straight towards the target. Hitting sideways straight to the target. And hitting backwards in a straight angle, in a vertical angle, hitting the target. So all the time, this family is striking the target in a vertical line. Pushing it, destroying it. Jarrett will demonstrate now stomping kick down to a target. The target that is down still poses a threat to you. You are lifting your leg and then striking down with your heel. The technique is being done with delivering your weight, sending your weight down to the target. You see that we use realistic training tools to enhance the learning. Note the rising of the knee when the person starts to kick. When you're being attacked in a bear hug, one of the things you can do is strike down with a stomp towards the instep, the toes of your opponent. This is just part of the technique that we have against the bear hug from the rear. Manny will demonstrate now, from a passive stance, a defensive kick forward. We're using this technique to push the opponent backwards, slowly. Manny is raising her leg, the knee is directed towards her shoulder, and then she is sending her heel forward in a straight line towards the target. We'll demonstrate it now fast from a fighting stance. This technique is excellent against an advancing attacker to stop him. Manny will demonstrate now the stages of learning for the defensive kick forward. We will start with stomping down, shifting the weight towards the target, starting with raising the knee. Now the kick will come more and more forward and up, as if the target is rising, and a bit higher. Notice that Manny is bringing her knee towards her shoulder, and she's shifting her weight more and more forward to create more of a push and more of a stronger kick towards the target. The striking surfaces can be the ball of the foot, the whole foot, or the heel, which is the strongest part. We can combine a regular kick forward and a defensive kick forward to hit a target that is vertical one, inward. Chavit is lifting his knee and then kicks forward with the ball of the foot. Other striking surfaces, of course, can be the heel or a point of a heavy shoe. And now with the forward leg. From a correct distance, Jarrett will kick fast towards the solar plexus and slow, hitting straight inward and fast two times again. Now, a defensive kick backwards. You raise your heel backwards and send the whole leg backwards in a straight motion. You must be looking towards the target, hitting with the heel, and the toes should be as much as downwards as possible. You should look by the side of your shoulder or under the arm. Chad will demonstrate for us now the learning stages of the defensive kick backwards. We will start with raising the heel backwards. Now we'd continue with bending forward, looking backwards by the side of the upper arm. Now we deliver a kick backwards. It is a straight kick backwards, sending the heel straight from the area that it brought to the target. The weight is delivered, sent in the direction of the attack, meaning landing backwards. Jared will demonstrate for us another member of the family of the stomping kicks. This is the side kick. And slow, we see that Jared is lifting his knee forward, then pivoting at the hip joint, sending the heel directly from the hip to the target. To initiate a strong hip movement, he's also pivoting at his base foot. The weight and the hip are directed towards the attack, towards the target. Mani will demonstrate for us now the learning stages for the side kick. We will start with a defensive kick backwards. Then we will turn a little bit to our right and kick to the same target as before, which is dangling behind us to our right. Then we will turn a little bit more and kick sideways. Let's break the movement, and we see that Marnie is lifting the knee and then pivoting at the hip, sending the heel to the side. And from here, in flow motion, we kick the side kick. The side kick can be delivered to different heights, such as the knee of the opponent. We are also bending our base knee, or at the midsection, the lower ribs of the opponent, or even up to his head, if you are flexible and able.
The defender must also know how to function if he or she should fall to the ground. Wade gives an example of someone who is down, but he puts himself in a readied position to deal with an aggressor who approaches him. At this point, Jared is approaching with the pad. Front kick is delivered sharply from the back position. You can see how Wade is shifting his weight onto the forward leg that's the base leg as he sends his hips forward and into the kick. The rhythm now can be broken, and you see the position has changed. Wade is more on the side and delivering something between a side kick and even a defensive front kick. Notice the defensive positions of his hands and how he rocks forward to put his weight in the kick. In this position, we watch as Wade is moving his body in order to deal with an aggressor who's attempting to change the angle of attack. As Jarrett moves to find a better way of attacking Wade, Wade is able to move in such a way that he's keeping the more vulnerable parts of his body, like his head and neck, at a further distance from the attacker. Less vulnerable target areas, such as the legs and feet, are presented towards the attacker so that less injury can be caused by any possible attack. In addition, when striking, if the strike is to a small target area, generally the foot is placed horizontal to the ground, parallel with the ground. This provides for a larger striking area on a smaller target. If the strike is delivered to a larger target area, the toes can be upward, similar to that of a front kick. That is due to the larger target area. In addition, once it is safe to do so, Wade can regain his stance by raising himself in an appropriate way to deal with the threat. As previously mentioned, we want to be able to strike at appropriate distances. That distance may be far, or that distance may be at an intermediate range. And of course, we must operate in close. When we were talking about punches, we were making long punches, and when we got in close, we reverted to the elbow strikes or even a headbutt. Now, in addressing what we're doing with our legs, at a further range we're kicking, and as we get in close, we make the variation and change to using our knees. Our knees can generate a great deal of power in a short distance, and it allows us a variety of tools in the fight. In this view, we'll watch Barney as she delivers a variety of powerful knee strikes to the target. Notice that when she's striking, she's using the actual front part of her knee. The knee is pointed, and the foot shoots off the ground and springs forward to deliver a powerful knee. She's pulling the opponent forward while the knee comes up to meet the target. It's a spring-like action, and she gains power from the ground as she springs up and forward to the target. The knee is pointed. The striking area is the knee itself, not the thigh. The smaller striking area offers more penetration than the larger area, such as a thigh. Also, it is a much harder striking surface than any other possible option in that area. Marnie will now demonstrate a series of knee strikes slowly. First, the catch. You see, as Marnie is delivering the right knee, she is pulling the target towards her. The combined force of the pulling of the target and the outward delivery of the knee gives greater power. Also, you'll see how she's pushing off with the ball of her foot as she gives the knee. It explodes forward, and she strikes with the actual front part of the knee. It is possible to grab someone around the neck, and in this case, she puts her elbows together as much as possible so that the opponent will not have the ability to slide their head out and escape her grasp. A side view also shows another possibility. Here she can grab the shoulders of the person she's giving the knee to. You see also her hips involved in the delivery of the knee. You see how she's pulling the person forward. And you see how her hands are up in a position that covers her face, and her head can be buried to avoid any possible strikes to that part of her body. In this next subject area, we deal with defending against strikes. In particular, we're dealing with those strikes that come from an outside angle in. The exercise is called 360-degree defense because we are defending at a 360-degree range around us. This exercise is also used as a training method to develop peripheral vision so that we can pick up on movement on the outside. Our defense is foundational and is created at a 90-degree angle to stop the given attack. Later, we'll be adding counterattacks so that we are defending and attacking together to stop any subsequent attacks. And further, this is very important to note that other exercises seen later in KNIFE and other subject areas are based on and are built from this foundational exercise. In this scene, we examined the 7 positions for 360-degree outside defense. John will now assume each position. The first position deals with an attack that is overhead and coming down on top of the head at almost a 90-degree angle. John raises the blade of the arm, the forearm, to defend. His blocking surface is from the tips of his fingers to his elbow and can deal with any threat in that zone. Notice that the bicep is close to his ears, this ensuring from this point in time that he will have coverage for the top of his head. Also, his chin is down so that his head is inside the defense. Position number 2. This deals with an attack to the head level coming from the outside at a diagonal downward angle. Again, the blocking surface is from the point of the tips of the fingers to the point of the elbow. And John is still and will continue to defend with the blade of his arm. Position number 3. An outside defense dealing with a horizontal attack almost parallel to the ground, still being delivered to the head level. Position number 4. Dealing with a defense for the lower part of the torso for an attack that's being delivered, again, horizontal or slightly upward at the torso. Position number 5. An outside defense dealing with a little bit lower part of the body and given when it's appropriate to do so and comfortable for the hands. This covers the same general area as position 4, but can be done or performed when the hands are in a comfortable position to make this defense. Position number 6 deals with closing of the circle at a lower level. Notice again that the forearms are defending. The blocking surface are from the fingertips to the elbow. And John is bending at the waist with slight minimal bend at the knees. If John were to bend the knees, he would bring the target area or the intended target closer to either the weapon or the striking implement. We keep the knees straight but not locked and the waist bent to keep the intended target area further away from the threat. Defense number 7 closes the bottom of the circle. Again, this defense deals with attacks that would be rising upward, almost at a 90-degree angle to the body. John is able to defend at this 90-degree angle to stop the attack. Again, defending with the forearms from the elbows to the fingers. A side view of each defense as presented with the right arm. 1. Defending the top of the head. Again, please. Notice how John is rotating his hand in a chopping-like motion and putting his weight in the defense and slightly forward. This allows for the defense to be strong, and we are almost defending with an attack. Defense position number 2, dealing with those attacks that may be delivered at a diagonal angle or downward. From this position, John again rotates his hand outward in a chopping-like motion to attack with the defense rather than just placing his hand in a stagnant position. Defense position number 3 deals with a horizontal attack parallel to the ground. Again, you can see the side of the forearm, the blade, so to speak, defending in this position. Position number 4, slightly downward angle, closing in on the body so that the elbow is supported by the side of the body. The blade offers the defense. Position number 5, again, defending with the side of the body, side of the forearm, and the side of the body is defended. Position number 6, out and down, dealing with an attack that is rising at a diagonal angle toward the body. And finally, position number 7, dealing with an attack that is coming straight up, from the bottom of the circle towards the target. In this position, please note how John's legs are straight. He's bending at the waist. This is to afford greater distance between the limb that is attacking, or the object, the striking implement, and John's vulnerable parts on his body. From this view, we can look at John Pascal as he's delivering various attacks to prepare for the 360-degree defense exercise. John is going to build his partner. The attacks come from all angles, from the very outside to the very top and down. The attacks can be delivered two at one time. The attacks can also be delivered in a broken rhythm. Two arms or single arm. John is defending as he's demonstrated before. In this position, the attacker is sending the attacks and John is looking towards the face or chest area of the attacker. He's using his peripheral vision to pick up on the movement of the attacking limb and defending with the appropriate 360-degree defense. Although we had seven positions, those were merely learning positions. Defenses can be offered at any or an infinite number of positions. The attacks also from this position can vary, meaning the rhythm can speed up. Two hands can be offered on top of one, which is referred to as broken rhythm, which has or forces John to respond with two defenses that overlap, or two simultaneous defenses occurring at the same time. The attacker can now spin and break up the rhythm, hiding the attack, to build, once again, the defender to be the best he can be to defend all possible outside type attacks that come toward him. A violent confrontation is sure to include multiple attacks. It's rare that someone in a fight gives a single attack. Here, John is defending one attack at a time. In our theory of defense, we realize that we want to be able to combine the defense, as John is now performing, with the counterattack. The reason for this is that the counterattack stops subsequent attacks, because the delivery of the punch and being hit by the punch causes the attacker to stall. It is difficult to send a punch when you're being hit by a punch. And this punch actually adds or serves as a defensive tool for the fight. In this scene, we'll examine progressive learning stages for the 360-degree defense exercise. A single attack is being delivered. The defender is defending close to the wrists, stopping the attack at a 90-degree angle. The attacker is bursting in at high speed. The attack is at various locations that are not predetermined. Now we add a counterattack. From this position, the defender is learning to give an attack with his defense. The last stage is as follows. From this position, the defender can burst in if he's ready to do so and follow up with additional attacks. One at a time, please. From a basic exercise, we're developing the tools you need to make the fight. Thank you.
we will introduce now another subject of defenses, and that is the inside defenses. Before we were talking about what happens if the attacker is coming from the sides and we were blocking the attacks. But what if the attacker is coming with a straight punch to hit you? Michael will show the defense. Michael will demonstrate now the hand defenses against straight punches. From a passive stance with the hands high, shoulder width apart, and about chin level, he will defend the straight punches. You send your palm dangling forward. You'll make contact first with the area of the back of the hand or the wrist of the opponent and slide to his forearm. You're also making a party defense, moving your head outside from the line of the attack. We can see this very good if Michael will be with the back to the camera. That's the way the inside defenses look from a fighting stance and fast. Send your hand dangling forward to meet the attack in an early stage of its development. This is the first stage of learning. Now we add the body defense, moving the head to the opposite side as the defending hand moves. This way, the attack will miss you. So you have two enhanced defenses, the hand defense and the body defense. Here are the inside defenses from a fighting stance. In future tapes, we will deal with counterattacking. These were the combatives. These were the tools that you need. These are the weapons that you need. Punching, kicking, all techniques, directions. We're using these techniques in a different subject, such as the self-defense part, releases, defending knife attacks and knife threats, defending gun threats. Other subjects such as defending stick and blunt object attacks. Remember to practice your combatives. These are your tools. These are your weapons. And your weapons must be effective.
Krav Maga training seminars, instructor programs, apparel, Krav Maga services and merchandise. Visit our website at www.kravmaga.com.